Well, let me just help you to understand something. You spent your whole week laboring earnestly and desperately for your own cause and service, for your mortgage, for your car, for your stuff. And the Lord wants to turn those interests at least one day out of the week completely and totally towards Him. The other morning, the Lord woke me up. I believe it was a Thursday morning or Friday morning, and the presence of the Lord was just so, it was Thursday morning, the presence of the Lord just so powerfully and radically upon me, and His cry for the church. It's not just this church. This is the churches throughout the United States, because we've become such an entertainment society. We've become such a culture of entertainment. I don't think ever in the history of man has men made idols and gods, demigods, out of musicians, because we're just such a culture of entertainment, out of actors. I mean, you know, they had a role to play as modernization took place. There was usually, they were just court jest, you know. But now they become everything, as it were, within our society. And so people now have ultimately tried to superimpose that culture upon the church, and so there's not the raw reality. And the Holy Ghost was saying, I'm looking in this vision in the night that He gave me, I'm looking for raw expressions of My glory through your passions. Listen to this. I'm looking for raw expressions. I mean, the real raw. You don't care about whether your hair's all messed up or whatever it might look like. It doesn't matter to you. It doesn't even matter what people are thinking. A raw expression of emotion towards God surging through our life by the rivers of the Holy Ghost. Think about it. Think about how far the church, many of people in the church of the Western world, are from this raw reality of the expression of God the Holy Ghost moving through them with joy and passion and thanksgiving, because praise is just another word for thanksgiving. And I mean, I've watched a lot of different folks express thanksgiving over earthly things, getting really happy about the fact that they got a new car, or they got a raise, or they got a promotion, or they got a well done, a good grade, or whatever. Those things should be, to you and me, meaningless. They're just meaningless. It's like, whatever. Because it really doesn't affect us, because we're living in another higher realm, a higher emotional realm, a higher passionate realm. People, joy is an emotion. I know people want to make it something else, but it's an emotion. Listen, love is an emotion. And the Lord's saying, let there be this joyful display of expression. In the dance, in the shout, Orestai in the Meki Shalomoki Akanaya. Lamanda. Don't feel like see people. I look at some of your faces and you look like you feel like you're being scolded. Ain't nobody scolding you. Come on. This is a cry of God. I mean, let me just say this. You can be seated for a second. I'm gonna help you with something. I wanna show you where Satan runs interferences and blockades. Listen to me. I'm going to say this to start with. God has called you to daily deny yourself. Now listen to me. There are very few people on the face of the earth in the church that even knows what that means, much less knows how to practically apply it and measure it on a daily basis. If there's anything you want to measure, it's not what's in your bank account, it's how you deny yourself. It's true, because there's nothing more important to us. Jesus said, above everything, go after the kingdom. Look, the number one thing is go after the kingdom. If you want to follow me, if you want to be my disciples, you take up your cross, you deny yourself daily. Follow me. Listen to me. I can help you with this. I can help you with this. If you will just listen, don't feel like you're being scolded. You're being called into glory. You're being called in an opportunity to be able to exercise yourself in the things that belong unto the life of God. Listen, if you had $1 trillion right now in your bank account, you would be spending it. You would be spending it. And I hope you spend it more on others than you did on yourself. But the Lord has put a treasure of His life in a bank account for us, an unmeasurable, all power, unlimited, amount of His glory and the expression of His nature and His goodness, and we don't spend it. We're like a person with $1 trillion in our bank account, and we live on the street, not in a shack, on the street, under a cardboard box, because we don't want to spend it. We don't know how to spend it. We don't know how to go to the ATM and get it out. We don't know how to walk up to the teller and say, give me my money. How much do you want? How much can I have? Well, you can have $1 trillion if you want it, but you're going to have to wait till we get the cash. So the Lord wants you to spend goodness, joy, love, thanksgiving, lowliness, meekness, humility, patience, long-suffering. He wants you to spend it. And the more you spend it, the more He deposits into the account. And the more you know how to do it. Oh, I know how to do this now. I know how to get my money and invest it now. I know what investments not to go with and what investments to go with. I know where the riches are. I know where the glory flows because I participated with this. I learned. You don't learn anything sitting at home or not engaging or being unwilling to participate. Somebody said, how do I get into glory? Receive it and do it. That's how simple it is. How do you get into the greatest miracle called salvation? You just go ahead and receive it. That's how you get everything else. It's true. It's true. The Lord just is looking for a raw display of your passions and your emotions. He saw what you got excited about this week. He saw what deeply touched you this week. He saw when you began to be overwhelmed by something that was of self-interest, and it elicited every emotional response, every passionate response in your being. And then He saw what happened when you came into His presence to worship Him, because maybe He's still an idol to many people. And I'm talking to people on the web too. And I'm talking to people in here. Maybe He's still just an idol. Maybe He's still just a concept. Maybe He's just a religious idea. Forgive me. Maybe He's not a living reality in your before you at this moment. But you can change all that. You can set God before you. You can choose to set Him before you. You can choose to believe what He said. I'm with you. I'm with you always, even unto the end of the age. Wherever two or three gather in my presence, I'm there. You can choose to set Him before you and recognize that the church is that which is seated in heaven. You can choose to set Him always before you and recognize that you are His temple, and He filled you up with all of His goodness and with all of His glory. Let me just tell you just real quickly about the measure of denying yourself. The measure of being able to look at self-denial. You could walk up to people and say, do you know the Lord Jesus? And they say, yeah, I can't live a day without Him. Do you have a relationship with Him that you feel that is meaningful and valuable? Yes, I do. I pray all the time. I pray without ceasing. And they'll give you a long list of things that to try to quantitate their relationship with the Lord. And if you ask them, do you deny yourself daily? They'll say, oh yeah, absolutely. How? And then you're going to get a blank stare. How do you deny yourself daily? When you're sad, do you refuse it and go with His joy? When your own life impinges upon you, do you deny it and say, I'm living for You? Huh? When you're overwhelmed with some kind of anger or response because somebody didn't treat you right. And you know, if I ask people, don't you want to be treated better? Don't you feel like people don't treat you fairly? A lot of the times I'd get a lot of harm, people waving their hands at me. And the Lord says, you need to deny that. I could paint people into a corner, cause you to recognize that you don't deny yourself daily on the most measurable, important, valuable interest that God demands. Because you can't live your life and His life simultaneously. You cannot live His life and your life simultaneously. You have to say, not my will, Father, Your will. Lord, right now I'm overwhelmed by circumstances, but I push all of that aside. I'm not making those things important to me. I'm going to deny that. Yeah, you know, this thing and that thing, and maybe even let's get it down to the basics. Let's just say you don't have the kind of food that you want to eat, or you don't have the kind of clothes that you want to wear. You don't allow it to touch your heart and overwhelm you. You just move it off to the side and say, Lord, it's not even important to me. Having clothing, having raiment and food, I am content. You, my provider, I thank You for what You have done for me. And Father, bigger than that, what You've got going on in the realms of heaven is far more interesting to me. And as you do that, you're literally setting aside those things that the self-life, not the fleshly life that primarily is identified with demonic works. I'm talking about the self-life that Jesus said, I deny myself. I don't live for myself. I don't do anything of myself. People don't get this. They don't get it. They don't get it in the context of church, because if you could get it, Satan would not be able to stop your prayers and put upon your face a disinterested look or a confused look or a look that is overwhelmed by the cares of this life. We see this everywhere. I mean, I have evangelists talk to me all the time and say, you just don't even imagine the gloom that is upon people in the churches. The cares of this life that has clouded them. You don't see the overshadowing of divine glory. You don't see the countenance of the presence of the Lord upon God's people as it's supposed to be. You see the cares of this life, the disinterest, the sorrow of sin, the burdens, those things that cause them to be heavy laden, which Jesus Christ died at Calvary's cross for them to be liberated from. They live under the weather and the influence of the rulers of darkness and the God of this age and the spirit of disobedience that is at work right now in the children of disobedience. People, Satan designed and created this world. He designed it. He designed it. Men didn't design it. He designed it. Touch not, taste not, handle not, for all shall perish with the using. I mean, James got radical. He said, if any man does not know how to bridle his own tongue, his religion is vain. Huh? He doesn't know God. I mean, yet Father gets it right down to the very basics of what's coming out of our mouth on a casual way, in a casual way. Jesus gets it down to the very basics. He's in a very casual way about giving account for even the jesting coming out of our, oh, I was just jesting, or oh, I was just joking. No. The Lord says, no, that is meaningful. I'm going to hold you into account for that joke. Something's going on there. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Keep with all diligence your heart. How am I going to do that? I've got to be willing to understand how to rule over my own spirit and submit my spirit to the Holy Spirit, because the miracle of salvation gave us the ability to do it. Before the miracle of salvation, our spirit could never be submitted to the Holy Spirit. It was foreign. It was absolutely in every way other than what God himself is. Now let me tell you something. Everybody sitting on this front row, you got to be full of the Holy Ghost. There's a gradation that goes down, full of the Holy Ghost, all the way back to basically empty and barren. So first one's here. You fired up, you know. And you have to do that, especially around men of God who function gift of discernment, word of knowledge, because what's going on in your life starts hitting us really hard. And then we had, you know, it's good, it's discipline. I used to cannot even handle it at all, because I got this word from the Lord, and then all of a sudden I'm getting hit with one thing after another, this stuff that's going on, and it's like I would constantly get off track and start dealing in a general way to try to keep people from being embarrassed, but just deal with the problems and the issues in a general way. I'm going to tell you right now, the one thing you want to do today is understand how easy it is to be forgiven, how easy it is to receive his divine grace and to be 100% restored and to have peace, which is the absence of condemnation. Peace is where God says, come on in, come near me. Because as soon as you do and you understand how easy that is, you're going to get happy real quick. It is amazing. Father made it so easy. He said, just repent. He said, just forgive. Just say, Lord, forgive me. And go forgive everybody who's trespassed you. Now, listen, against you. Now, what happened is I see this. And I'm going to hit this real quick because, you know, I have to deal with it. Because I get off track. And when it looms out at me, it's like, okay. Look, you can ask God to forgive you. But if you won't forgive the person that you're holding an offense against, and I'm telling you, it's always fresh, people. It ain't, you got something you got to sit around and think about real hard, okay? It's fresh. It's on you, okay? And you're not willing to forgive them, forget about it. Father said, I'm not listening to you. Go forgive them first, then come back, and I receive the gift. And what gift do you want to present to him? Your life. What offering does he want? Life. He don't want your money. Huh? All the cattle belong to him. All the cattle. All the lambs, all the goats, all the sheep, all the money, all the vegetables, all the fruits, all belong to him. You don't need any of that. What does he want? Broken and contrite heart. He wants your life, the sacrifice of your life. In a very good way. to where that you recognize, wait a minute, I'm not living in a way that you didn't design for me to live. I'm not living in sorrow and sadness. Redemption has come. I'm living in joy and gladness. People, you're going to have to understand, you've got to deny yourself daily to have that reality in your life. Anything that's in the Bible, you're going to have to deny yourself about to have what God says. Because there is the realm of human ability, there is the realm of demonic influence constantly running interference against you. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about this, okay? I want you to open your Bibles, Colossians chapter 1, verse 11. I'm not going to tell you. I'm not entertaining you. I'm correcting you. I'm jerking you into line with the kingdom of God. Hey, you know what? Let me just tell you something. The worst thing that God can think of is a person who bears false witness. The worst thing that God can think of in the Bible is a person who bears false witness. Listen to me. The worst thing that God can think of in the Bible is a person who bears false witness. How about bearing false witness against the Father? Because you're living a false life when it comes to representing Him. Huh? I know that this, you know what? Here's what I see in a modern day church. As soon as I start talking like this, I see the masses and the multitudes filing out the door to go listen to someone tell them how well they're doing, how good they're doing, how fine it's going to be, how grace is extended them to live any way that they want to live. It's all good. It's all okay. You're better now. You came here to feel better, and we're here to make sure that you feel better. There's only one way for you to feel better, and that is to cooperate with all that heaven has supplied. And so we're going to help you understand. We're going to get real with you, and we're going to show you how to live a better life. How to live the feel better life. We want you to understand how to live in divine health. We want you to learn how to live in divine love and divine joy. We want you to learn how to live in divine blessings. I mean, we want you to learn how to live in divine thanksgiving. I mean, you know what? It's too much. I see people reducing the glory of the salvation to a place of monetizing it. And talking about money and money and money. Goodness gracious, people, there's so much more going on. The true riches go way beyond the dollar bill, way beyond a Benjamin Franklin image or a George Washington image. My goodness, dear people, please hear the word of the Lord. This is the day of His power. The scripture says that His people will be willing in the day of His power. That's why I'm so willing. I live in the day of His power. I'm already in heaven. I'm not waiting till I die to go to heaven. I've already been judged. My judgment is found in Christ Jesus. I've already been made righteous. He's given it to me, a righteousness by the faith of Him. My life is already written out and planned out by the living God. I'm not going to live my own life for a period of time and then one day turn myself over to the Lord to do whatever it is He's got on His plans and agenda for me. My goodness, the best life that there is for you and I to choose is the life that God Himself has. And God's people live far beneath that joy unspeakable and full of glory. They live far beneath that peace that passes understanding. And I'm telling you, I'm calling you up. I'm not scolding you. Don't look like I'm scolding you. I'm calling you up. You're only going to be sad because you're not willing to go. The rich man was sad. Jesus gave him an opportunity. And he was sad because he regarded his riches more important and more valuable to him than the opportunity that Jesus gave him. That's the only condition. That story is written out for us so that we can understand the disposition of God's people being sad. An opportunity given, but they're not willing to go and take it up. We understand why people get mad. The only people that got mad with Jesus was Pharisees. The religious people became very mad. They want to take the greatest person, greatest preacher, most wonderful human being that ever lived and throw him off the cliff because they felt in their own thinking that such a person had no right to live, that they were a contamination to humanity. That's pretty radical, isn't it? You think about how much room Christ Jesus has in this world. He has none. That's why He was born in a manger in a cave. He was born with the cows and the sheep and the chickens because there was no room for Him. It wasn't just a coincidental event where there was just so many people in Bethlehem on that day. There was no room for Him among the places that men had built with their own hands. In the world system that men had become so comfortable living in, who pride themselves on their skill sets and their ability. Father, has been at the just cause of trying to help man understand that it is not by human effort and human ability that men will walk in the realms of heaven, a place that a lifestyle that pleases God, but it's by His Holy Spirit. It's by the act of His divine power. It's by the act of His divine enabling. We see it from the very beginning, and it's highlighted with Abraham in his attempts to bring to pass God's promise with Hagar and the child Ishmael. And after the woman had already gone through menopause, Sarah, and her womb was barren and she had no more estrous cycle. I'm going to break it down for you. There was no more ability for her to have any conception within her womb. And Abraham was old. And I'm not going to go into that part. He was old. God, when man was way past his own ability, when no longer could it be anything that he could do of his own self and strength, he then showed, it's not by might and it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. It's God giving by His grace the divine gifting, the divine enabling. And you want to know about your divine gifting and your divine enabling, God has given you a very clear direction, a very clear understanding of it. To those things which He's declared in His Word. None of it fails. None of it's going to pass away. The opportunity is given to all, everywhere. Nobody is excluded. Not by nationality, race, it does not matter. Even the worst of society, like the Scythians, which were the most immoral people in the day of Paul. Everyone on an equal basis with God. I want you to open your Bibles with me to one of my favorite passages of Scripture in beginning Colossians chapter 1 verse 10, but the emphasis and my focus is on verse 11. Of course, Colossians 1:13 is a verse of Scripture that I probably quote more than any other verse of Scripture in the Bible, because I want people to realize that you're living in heaven today. If there's anything that you and I should be able to grasp is that in the Word of God is that there is an opportunity for us to dwell and walk and live in the Spirit, and that is a synonym with the realms of heaven, that we could actually have days of heaven upon this earth. If in the Old Testament and under the Old Covenant, people were allowed to have days of heaven upon the earth just because they were willing to obey God, how much more now that we have been made the temple of the living God in which the Holy Spirit dwells, who also have been overshadowed with the glory and the presence of the power of Almighty God. Hallelujah. Ha. Having been made with one with the Father, having access into heaven by the Spirit, having a privilege and the ability to live in, not only enter, but live in the holies of holies, the actual holies of holies by the blood of Jesus Christ, the new living way, which is consecrated for us, the veil of His flesh. Amen. Hallelujah. Ha ha. That's enough to shout about. That's enough to praise God about. That's enough to get happy about. Don't let sorrow fill your heart. Hallelujah. Let joy fill your heart. Sorrow can only access you because there's something valuable to you outside of the realm of heaven. I'm going to say it again. Sorrow can only access you because something's valuable to you outside the realm of heaven. Mark that thing and decide that it has no more place in your life. Mark that thing. Mark that thing. That thought, that issue, that event, that thing that would cause an open door for sorrow to fill your heart. It has nothing to do with heaven. There's no sorrow in heaven. There's no crying in heaven. Amen. He wipes away all the tears from our eyes. Does that mean we don't get burdened and begin to cry out to God for a lost and dying world? We don't feel the same things that the Holy Spirit feels in His passion for a lost and dying world? Surely we do. But you know, there's always the comfort of the Holy Ghost that's there. And if God's people would just be willing to grab a hold of the poor in spirit who mourn are meek, they hunger and thirst for righteousness. That when we read in Matthew chapter 5, and we call it the Beatitudes, blessed are they. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That we're not just talking about different, distinct, you know, dichotomized virtues and dispositions of your life, but something that is integrated. If you have one, you have the other. Blessed are the poor in spirit who mourn, they're meek. The poor in spirit who mourn are meek. They hunger and thirst after righteousness. They're merciful, pure in heart, and peacemakers too. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. They shall be comforted. They shall inherit the earth. They shall see God. Great is their reward. I pray that you'll grab a hold of these things. I pray that you'll teach your children these things. Too many people are watching and teaching their children and setting before their children evil things. You know, my wife was just commenting on a little video that's out now that's become a rage, and it's just witchcraft. And what is it called? It's called Frozen. And all the kids are excited about Frozen. Oh, it's innocent. Oh, there's no problem with it. No. You're setting before them another value system. It has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. I'm sorry that no one stepped up from the side of utilizing the artistic form of movie media and done something that's so much more beautiful and so much more entertaining and so much more captivating to where that we as God's people would captivate the world rather than the world captivating us. My God in heaven, something's bad wrong, you know. There has to be a revival. That revival is found brooding in the context of our lives because the Holy Spirit is brooding over us. He's hovering over us. He's stirring us. He's even as we see him in Genesis chapter 1, brooding over the vast expanse of a desolate and empty earth to bring forth the life of God so it become visible and fruitful and a blessing to all. God wants to bless us so that we become a blessing to all. And he wants us to have a value system that is totally different than the value system that we've been taught, that has been imposed upon us, that we bought into. I have nothing against football, but I'm going to tell you right now, competition doesn't exist within the kingdom of heaven. It's totally opposite. That's Hellenistic. It's totally opposite. The Lord is on the meek side. He's on the let you win side kind of thing. Bless you side. It's true. I mean, if God's people could just understand it's not whether you win or lose, it's how you play the game, they would actually have stepped a little bit closer to heaven and a little bit more out of the influences of a culture designed by a satanic power. People haven't got the concept enough of heaven and of the Word of God to even believe that what I'm saying is true. So it's puzzling to them because they're so indoctrinated, so ingrained, so taken over by the philosophies of this world that have spoiled them. Hey, religious philosophies, they're almost powerless compared to the almost, as it were, sterile philosophies, what we believe to be sterile philosophies of the world that we bought into hook, line, and sinker, and we accept it as normal. We call it normal. It's not normal. It's not normal. What's normal is what God created and intended us to have. What's normal is meek. He said, be meek. Did you know, and tonight I'm going to minister on this. I'm not going to minister on it right now. That God will shake the wicked out of the earth. I'm ministering on tonight. God will shake the wicked out of the earth. It's not normal. It's a contamination. It's a pollution. It's a worse pollution. It's far worse than plutonium. It's far worse than if San Onofre was to ultimately, you know, have a catastrophe. And earthquake, ultimately, it's amazing how we are so brilliant. We build nuclear power plants on fault lines in America. We're geniuses. and the contamination that would result where it's at, the aquifers, the water, that not to speak of also the ocean, the waterfront. My goodness gracious. But there is a worse contamination than that. It's the culture of men. Iniquity, wickedness. You got your Bibles open? Let me grab mine. Hallelujah. I believe if God's people would just simply go photocopy Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, staple it together, and that would become their Bible. And they would devote themselves to now living and obeying and observing what Matthew 5, 6, and 7 says, there would be great change and great revival in the earth. I think maybe we have just been overwhelmed with too much information. Reality of it is God saying the same thing over and over again in different ways. So let's just focus for a few days, a few weeks. I told some people the other day, I said, would you like your life to be, there's actually some preachers, I said, would you like your life to be absolutely, absolutely and radically changed? All I want you to do, and they looked at me and said, absolutely. I said, okay, what I want you to do is I want you to only look at what John the Apostle wrote in the Bible. I want you to do it for 1 month. 1 month only. First, second, third epistle of John, the Gospel of John, and the book of Revelation. Read it over and again. And your whole life will be changed. You will have a new definition of what it means to be saved. You will have a new definition of what God expects of our lives. Then when you're finished with that, if you can get through in a month, because that's a person who's going to devote his life to study the Word, because that is our job description, giving ourselves to the Word and prayer. And I pray that you would make that more and more your job description, to give yourself to, I'm telling you, it's the most blessed life that you could possibly have. To give yourself to the life to interacting, talking with the Father, because the more you talk with Him, the better you get at it, and the more you talk to Him, the better you hear what He has to say. And the more you interact with reading the Word, and it's not just information purposes only, but it's literally spirit and life. It's creative power on the inside of you. It's faith building, life changing. Everything starts getting more and more beautiful, more and more splendid. So I hope that you come on in and let that become your job description too, even though you have another vocation in life. Believe me, you can be bivocational. Paul was. He made tents and also preached because he didn't want to be chargeable or depending upon anyone for his daily provision. Pretty radical stuff, isn't it? God has called you and me to shine as lights into this world. Matthew chapter 5, I just want to emphasize that before I show you these passages in Colossians chapter 1. He's called us to shine as lights into this world. Let me just say this one other thing, because I was going to say it. I know some people were saying he left off the story. He left off what he's saying. After you're done with John, go to Peter. Read 1st and 2nd Peter and the Gospel of Mark, which we believe and understand that Peter was the author of, the overseer of, as Mark was a servant to him in it. And if you do that, your life will be radically changed. If you spend a month doing nothing but reading 1st and 2nd Peter, your definition of salvation would change. It would change. So I just challenge you to do that as well. But let me go back to Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Because if you took Matthew 5, 6, and 7, all of you, and this is God's people, I'm talking to God's people here in this place, you took Matthew 5, 6, and 7, and you began to live by it. First and foremost, let me say this. If you've not been born of the Spirit, you can never live Matthew 5, 6, and 7. It's absolutely impossible. You would have no ability. You would have no power. You would have no strength. You would not be able to remember this for 1 second. You would give up for lack of trying, and then you would give up the failed few attempts in which you did try, okay? Because you ain't going to do it. It's by supernatural divine ability. You know, we look at that verse of Scripture, and the Lord says, let your light shine, in Matthew chapter 5, let your light shine before men that they may see your good works. And He's all talking about within the framework of the disposition and nature of God. Jesus said, hey, all you that are laboring and heavy laden, look, I got your way out right here. I got your way of escape. Come unto me. I'll give you rest. Come and learn. This is a place. Here's the realms of life. It's totally opposite to everything that you've been taught in this world. It's lowliness and meekness. Listen, the concept of evolution came right out of the mind of Satan. He is the one who absolutely wants to destroy every weak and meek thing. Are you listening to me? He is the one who, the idea of the survival of the fittest, those who are going to kill so that they're not killed, those that are going to dominate over everybody else. That's just right out of the mind of Satan. Everything that you see in this world that men hold dear, that they call valuable, that they look up to, is absolutely opposite from Father's perspective. He despises it. He says this. He said, to the lowly or to the humble, I'll give them grace. But to the proud, I myself will personally come and fight against that person. God's going to shake the wicked out of the earth. Yes. You would not realize that. But if you could just begin to grasp this, if you could step over top of, run through the troop of humanism, leap over the wall of all the idealisms of men within the framework of what they think is good and right, because they call evil good. And we're always always being contaminated by that unless we have the shield of faith, unless we have the defense of God's word, unless our minds are kept and girded up by the helmet of salvation, by this very working of the power of the living God in our lives. People, you need to be vigilant and sober, because your adversary, the devil, goes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And he's very subtle in the way he does things. He gets you without you even knowing. Listen to me. God's made a way of escape, and you can't compromise it. You can't think that you know how to mitigate it. You can't think you know how to balance it. God's call is not something that you and I can choose and pick what we like and discard what we don't. He's made a way of escape. He's saying, run. He's saying, run over here. Flee from the wrath to come. That's the way Paul said it. Run over here. Run. I heard that personally. I heard that call of the Holy Ghost, and I came running. And now I'm living in this place of light divine. And as you walk in the light, my goodness, the darkness is very apparent. If you live in the shadows, you know, come on. It's a place of deception. You can think that you're in the light, but it is a very, you're in the shadows. You're in the shadows. The Lord says, let your light shine. He's talking about poor in spirit, mourning, being sorrowful over wrongdoing, wanting to be right with God. He's talking about walking in meekness, the lowliness and humility that Jesus showed us. Once again, you can't do it by the Holy Ghost. You can't do it but by the Spirit of God dwelling on the inside of you. And I really want to emphasize it to you. That's why we're going to go over here in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 11, and we're going to focus on this here in just a minute. I just want to set the stage for you so that you can really appreciate Colossians 1:11 and not just read past it real quick. Okay? That's why I think it's good for people to learn Greek. It'll slow you down. You'll have to wrestle with each word. And God has made a way so that we have so much, you know, resources to be able to work through it. That's why it's good to learn Hebrew. There's just not, if you think that you're not smart enough, I'll just rebuke that. Rebuke that right now in Jesus' name. And wrestle with each word of God. Each word of God is living. Each word of God is powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It'll divide soul from spirit, joint from marrow. It is a discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart. It will cause you to understand good from evil, right from wrong, what is of God and what is of Satan. It will cause this discernment to work in your life with such accuracy. People talk about, they get all excited about the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom. And yeah, it is exciting. I love the word of knowledge and word of wisdom. But there's nothing more important in these last days than the gift of the discerning of spirits. Nothing is more important in these last days. There is not a gift more important, not an operation of the Holy Spirit more important to God's people than the discerning of spirits. For there are many spirits, false prophets, liars, deceivers that have gone out into this world. The spirit of Antichrist is increasing. It's not decreasing. There is a place being given to the emergence of a great Antichrist satanic revelation and manifestation on a scale that goes beyond what you read about in Revelation, forgive me, in Genesis chapter 6. Satan will come in the earth. He will demand men to be his slaves, and he will stamp them with the stamp of slavery and demand all the world to bow down and worship him. It was seen in Nimrod. Mount Nimrut is an ancient ruin that gives us an indication about what's getting ready to happen. It's a ruin that still exists today. Mount Nimrut still exists. Indication. What happened with Nebuchadnezzar is an indication of where the world is going. The Lord said, unless those days be shortened, even the very elect would be deceived. Listen, if Satan can deceive the mighty host of angels who stood round Father, beholding his glory for undefinable length of time, what can he do to you and me? Come on, we're going to have to sober up and recognize that there's only one light unto our path. That there's only one means by which truth can be made manifest to us. We're going to have to take a hold of the Word of God. We're going to have to take a hold of that which the Holy Spirit is doing and cleave unto Him with the purpose of our life. We're going to have to be more to the Holy Spirit than Ruth was to Naomi. Come on. These aren't just little stories. These are indications of pure hearts, of committed souls and lives to the realms of the kingdom of God, and especially to the King of the kingdom. There's not a more precious gift and opportunity, not a greater treasure and blessing given to men in this life than the gift of the Holy Ghost and the movings and the operations of the Holy Ghost. And the Word of God teaches us how to connect with the Holy Ghost so that we know what He's doing. My Uncle Charles, who's a theologian, was a part of a great company of theologians that brought forth some wonderful benefit to the church in the 40s and the 50s. Said wisdom is knowing what God is doing and doing it with them. And God's Word has given us the wisdom to know what God is doing so that we can do it with them. And I'm going to tell you, you'll be successful in the kingdom. It's not quantity, people. Don't cheapen the gospel. It's not quantity, it's quality. Don't cheapen the gospel in your life. Understand the riches, the treasure, the value. Watch out, because your house might be standing in the way. Your car, your materialism, your desires of what men have made to be important. It's really, truly not an American dream. It truly is an American nightmare. It's all about consuming your whole life on materialism. Making the value of a man based upon how much money he has in the bank, what kind of clothes he wears, how good of English he speaks, what degrees he got it and has received, and where he got his degrees from. Nonsense! Designed by the prince and power of the air, the god of this world, the spirit that works in the children of disobedience. You won't be shining there. I watch as God's people built themselves up instead of daily denying themselves. It's what is important to me, what's valuable to me, how you're treating me. God says, deny that. Because all that is a strife and division and argument. All that is a self-reliant. Huh? You just snatched out of God's hands your life. You snatched away from God those things that you want Him to heal and to bless. You snatched it out of His hands and said, no, me, mine, for me. This is the way I want it to happen. This is the way I want it to go down. I'm not being treated fairly. It's not going down like I want it to happen in my life. Why is other people blessed more than I am? Dear people, come on now. Understand what Father has done. And what He has within the culture and the framework of the kingdom of God, because it's totally opposite of everything that's going on. I've heard great anointed men of God say, if you want to know what God's doing, look at what the church is doing, do just the opposite. That's pretty bad, isn't it? If you want to know what God's doing, look at what the church is doing, do just the opposite. My God in heaven, I heard those kinds of statements and I said, can it be that bad? Is it that bad, Lord? And I heard from heaven, yeah, it's that bad. It's that grievous to me. It's that big of a false witness. That's why by and large in most cities of the world, the church impacts less than 1%. Less than 1%. That is terrible. Imagine what would happen if you would be so stirred in relationship with God that your praise became passionate, that your expression of thanksgiving became radically display of joy and ecstasy. Somebody said, oh, that will just look too. That will look like the woman who came in with an alabaster box, let down her hair and began to kiss Jesus' feet and wash His dirty feet with her tears and dry them with it. That would just be obscene. Everybody would leave. No, everybody would come.
Why? Because men's heart in truth and in purity would begin to touch heaven, and power and glory would begin to surge through our lives like rivers to a dry and thirsty land. People everywhere are desperate to see God. They desperate. And all they got to look at is yours and my frowning face and dissatisfied disposition. Because they see us running after the same thing that they're running after. It's like one friend of mine was out riding some big waves, and he paddled over and started talking to some surfers about the Lord. They said, "Get out of here, man. We saw you scratching for the waves just like everybody else." That's it. That's the world. Somebody has enough perception to go ahead and say it. We saw you scratching for the waves just like everybody else. Buy in for your position. Are you with me? Come on, man. Come on now. God shows us how to wake up. He wants us to shine. How? Poor in spirit. Mourning. Meek. Merciful, pure in heart, peacemakers, intercessors, not accusers. I believe that people have not really even defined for themselves what gossip is, and gossip is one of the worst sins known to man, outside of murmuring and complaining. Oh no, we make homosexuality and adultery and murder really bad. Those are bad, but I'm going to tell you right now, murmuring and complaining and gossip is just as full of iniquity and sin. And it comes right out of the stout heart of pride that Satan himself invented. Anything that would in any way demerit or undermine or reduce the value of any human being is gossip. It is. It's iniquity. And the world looks on and says they're no different from the rest of us. Look at them talking bad about each other. Listen, yield your members as instruments to righteousness. Quit being part of what Satan is doing, slandering and accusing, because there's various gradations of accusation and slander. And Father's not anywhere in that. And here we are yielding our members to that which we want to resist, because we don't know how to yield to the Holy Ghost. And if we'll say no to that, if we first and fundamentally deny ourselves because somehow you were hurt and mistreated, that's why you're talking bad about that person. Set that stuff aside. Deny it. Say it has no place. Deny whether or not you got hurt, because that's personal, you know. Feelings. You're not dead to them. Are you with me? You're alive to God, so that now you can say, this isn't important. This stuff is all lost in the confusion of interpretation and in the deception of perception. And you can just move that aside and say, the only way that I can see truth and know what really is going on is to take heed unto the Word of God. If you give yourself and yield yourself as intercessors, you'll be yielding yourself to the ministry of Jesus and yielding yourself to the Holy Ghost. And the more you yield to Him, the better you're going to get at it. And the more you allow the Holy Spirit to course through your life and soul, the more He's going to be able to. Because I'm telling you, all power is given to you. Father has not withheld any good thing. The unlimited authority and grace of God is yours. But you got to start spending it. You got to start using it. It's got to become valuable to you. You got to start enjoying this. It's not some sacrifice. It's an opportunity. Hallelujah. It's better than you being promoted and voted into being the king of the world. Or the queen. It's far better. Because Father, where He's invited us to come and sit with Him and oneness with Him and union with Him is far above king of the world. Let Jesus touch your hearty heart. He wants to comfort you. If you'll come and live in this place, you'll never be offended or hurt again. In the sense that it holds on to you. You may be offended or hurt, but you can just push it right aside. Think about it, your people. Are you listening to me? And you can yield yourself over to the Lord. You say, Lord, let me see their state and their situation. Let me see what's going on in their life. And then the Lord, Holy Ghost, will fill you with compassion for them. And you'll be able to love your enemies. Hallelujah. And then out of that love for them, you'll have mercy. And now you'll be able to do good to them. Out of that mercy, you'll be able to forgive them. Love produces mercy. Mercy produces forgiveness. That's why Father never runs out of either. Because he that dwells in love dwells in God. And I'm telling you right now, listen, you want to have the best life? Just choose love. Just choose it. In the choosing of love, you find yourself being blessed again and again. People get cursed and can become overwhelmed with disaster because they constantly find themselves not choosing to love. Now I'm going to read the scripture to you. Always takes me a long time to read it. Verse 10 is radical, that you might walk worthy of the Lord. Can I walk worthy of the Lord? Absolutely. And if you don't believe you can, you never will, because it's impossible to please God without faith. And everything that happens is by virtue of the working and power of faith. If you want one gift to operate in your life, have faith, because it's going to be the function of all other, the operation of all other gifts. And faith's going to work by love. And that's the kind of love that only God can give us through Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, supplied to us by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit himself. Amen. What a way to go, I'm telling you. Walk worthy of the Lord and all pleasing. Being fruitful in every good work. And there you will begin to increase in the knowledge of God. And you'll have increase with the increase of God in your life. You say, I just want more of the anointing. I want more of an increase of God. What does it take for me to get into this? Just start at the beginning. Enjoy the relationship. Just be so happy that God loves you so much that Jesus is your Lord, your Savior, the Holy Spirit, your companion that lives on the inside of you. Be so happy about the relationship that you begin to obey him, and out of that love for him, you begin to find yourself consumed with the interest that Father has towards you. And you begin to participate with that which the world calls meaningless and valueless. Hallelujah. You won't be excited about things that you're excited about anymore. I think some people need to just look at God and just be honest with him. Say, Lord, I don't hate evil. I love it. And I don't even understand why I should love righteousness. Because I believe a lot of people find themselves in that state. And then just simply go, but Lord, I want to learn to hate evil. Because people have different definitions of evil. Well, murder is evil. Oh, yeah, it is evil. It's bad. And everything we call bad, those people are going to hell. And everything we call good, those people are going to heaven. But that ain't the way it works. That ain't the way it works. Because I'm telling you right now, if you're still murmuring and complaining, if you're still talking bad about people, you're caught up in evil. You are entrapped in evil. And it's just as evil as any other evil. Huh? The Lord wants you to learn how to keep your tongue from evil and to your lips that they speak no slander against anyone, no gossip against anyone. He wants you to do good and pursue peace with everyone. Come, my children, hearken unto me. Isn't it wonderful Papa called us children? Isn't it wonderful he gave us the authority to be sons of God? Not sons defined by angels, sons defined by the only begotten Son, Jesus. Huh? Because we're made one with him. We don't exist outside of Jesus. You do not exist outside of Jesus. I do not exist outside of Jesus. All that we are to God and in God is in Christ. In him. Hallelujah. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. I thank you. This is where praise is birthed in my heart on Sunday mornings. I thank you, Lord, that you brought me into the kingdom. Hallelujah. That I am in you. That is better than thinking that I have become the richest man in the world or whatever, you know, men ultimately hold as, you know, that which is the most valuable thing they could achieve, the best athlete. Oh, that's crazy. That's so Greek. That's so Hellenistic, with an emphasis on the H-E-L-L. And yet it is what we choose to exonerate and deify and glorify and make so important that men spend hours of training each day while the true riches and realities neglected. The Lord called you and I to walk worthy of this holy vocation, this wonderful position, this divine authority. I'm going to tell you, dear people, being seated with Christ Jesus in the heavenly realm is more than just a place of authority. It's an experience of divine glory. I mean, come on, if we would just set our affections on things above, we won't be all wrapped up with everything that's going on in this life. We will have a new definition and meaning and value system. Father's calling us to get out of the intellectual realms and the libraries of men and come in to the school of the Spirit. A.A. Allen, God gave A.A. Allen an amazing gift of authority over demon spirits. And A.A. Allen had a vision one day, and he saw literally the demon spirit of intellectualism governing libraries of men, demonic strongholds. That's pretty radical, ain't it? Because people are just fascinated by intellectualism. Nothing against education. Watch out what it'll do to you. Watch out what it'll do to you. When Jesus isn't first, it'll ruin you. I've discovered that most people can't handle education, because it goes right to their head. Because Jesus didn't fill their heart. And they become arrogant. And there's nothing that God hates more than arrogance. The forward look, arrogance. Well, there is one thing he hates more than forward look, the arrogance. There is one thing. Who knows what that one thing is that God hates more than that? That is correct. You win the prize. Fill him, Lord Jesus, with more wisdom and knowledge. Jason said, the sower of discord, the one who sows discord among the brethren. The one that says, did you hear about what Sister Leslie said about you? Did you see so-and-so's attitude when you said such and such? Did you know that Brother John doesn't really like you? I heard him talking. This goes on. And it's evil. It's evil. And men hear it. And Satan designs it and sets it up to that for that person who is right there ready to be harvested in the kingdom. They get to hear it. The satanic assignment always seems to prevail through the misdeed and conduct and evil of God's people. True. You need to keep your tongue from evil, your lips should speak no good. You need to watch yourself. You need to set a watch upon your mouth. Keep the door of your lips. That you might walk worthy of the Lord and to all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and there increasing in the knowledge of God. Listen to this. Being strengthened. Listen to this. Being strengthened. Listen to this. Look at this. Being strengthened with some power. See that? See that? It doesn't say being strengthened with some power. It says being strengthened with all power. God said, I've given you an unlimited resource. I've given you an unlimited empowerment. I've given you an unlimited ability. It's not by might and not by power. You're going to have to learn how to deny yourself. It's not by your own human efforts, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. I've given you an unlimited power. All you got to do is yield your members to the Holy Ghost. All you got to do is be willing to cooperate with what the Word of God says, even when you don't want to. Wait a minute. My judgment is this. My judgment is this person did me wrong, and they are worthy to be hated or disliked. That's not Papa's judgment. It's not a Papa judged. Whose judgments do we want to go with? I don't want to live under your rule. Come on now. You want to live under the rule of men for all eternity? That'd be hell. People want God to accept them as they are. Well, if he did, heaven would be no different than hell. It'd be no different than the disaster of every man's turn working out his own will today and the results of that. It'd be no different. And God isn't going to accept anybody as they are. He changes us to be like him. Hallelujah. And I'm happy with that. And I mean, listen, my heart is saddened that those who sat in the shadow of death, those who sat under the power of darkness, light has sprung up. And they saw great light. But they love darkness more than light, because they love evil more than that which is right. Not me. Not me. If you don't love righteousness and hate evil, ask God to fill your heart with the love for righteousness and the hating of evil. And he'll transform you and make you a new man. He'll give you a divine nature. He'll give you his own heart. He's looking for somebody who has a heart after him. You know, he found David. He found David, a man after his own heart. But you know how David got a heart just like Father's? He gave it to him just like he gave it to Saul. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Saul and changed him into another man, and he gave him another heart. God found a man willing to walk humbly. See, in the beginnings of Saul was not great in his own eyes. He was small in his own eyes. And when he was small in his own eyes, God could do great things for him. When the brethren of David were called, David wasn't even considered an option. Is there no more brethren here? You have no more brothers? There is David. We didn't think to fetch him. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon David. And in that place of lowliness, in that place of submission and obedience to his daddy, his earthly daddy, he was taught how to be in obedient submission to his heavenly Father. Come on now. Children have no right to walk around with hurts towards their parents. My goodness gracious. That's nonsense. People need to step up and look at the bigger picture of life. They get lost in the little force of self-interest and the details of some personal event. We're experts at taking one negative thing and eclipsing one negative thing with 9,990 positive things. Now let me say 9,999,990, you know. $999,999, right? Good things. It needs to be the other way around. One good thing would eclipse all the bad. One good thing eclipses all the bad. Jesus died for us and made his body an offering for our sins and for our soul, and eclipsed every evil thing so that all men could come in. Satan works his demonic work because we are not willing to obey God. And it begins with denying ourselves. We have been strengthened with all power. Think about this, dear people. Be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Ephesians 16. Take unto yourself the whole armor of God, especially that breastplate of faith. Or rather, carrying me, that breastplate of righteousness. Knowing who you are in God and walking in righteousness, having been made righteous by the faith of him. It's all power. Come on, think about this. Be strengthened with all power. Somebody said, I need to be strengthened. Well, you got all power right now to be strengthened with. Right now, somebody said, how do I get it? Receive it, just like you receive salvation. Have it. It's yours. Say, it's mine. Now do what you're supposed to do with it. Listen, be strengthened with all power by his kratos. Kratos is power to rule and control. Be strengthened with all power by his glorious kratos, his glorious power to rule and control. Let the peace of God rule and control your heart and your mind. The peace where there is no condemnation, where there's no sense of sin, no sense of failure or offense. My, that God's people would taste of the goodness of his salvation. Oh, that God's people would taste of the goodness of his riches towards us in Christ Jesus. And begin to drink freely of the Spirit of life. Being strengthened with all power according or by his glorious kratos, his glorious ability. His glorious divine ability to rule and control, where he rules and controls our lives by the Holy Ghost.
Somebody say, don't say that the Holy Spirit would control you. He comes with kratos, and kratos means to control and to rule. I'm not interested in the theological ideas of men. I'm interested in hearing the heart of the Father that is only expressed by His words, not in men's interpretation of His word. His glorious kratos, for one outworking, for one beautiful display of a light shining into a dark world, a wonderful, beautiful display of the good works of God manifested in our life. Men seeing in us patience, endurance, and joyfulness. Well, I thought all the power and everything was for us to do signs, wonders, and miracles. Long's patience, endurance, and joyfulness is signs, wonders, and miracles. When have you seen somebody walking always putting relationships? We are not taught in our culture to make relationships more valuable than getting a job done. Huh? Our performance, our quantified amount of the things we got done in a day, that's what we're going to get raises and promotions for. That's what we're going to get money for. How many sales were made at the end of the day, not how good of our relationships. You're going to be fired for relationships. You start going around socializing with people at work, you're going to get fired. You start making people's needs and the things of their life a bigger and more important thing to you than how many widgets you make in a day. You're fired. It's not that way with Father. Relationships is more important to Him than anything else. Beginning relationship with Him and His relationship with us. There's hierarchy of relationship. And God says, men, you dwell with your wives according to knowledge, or I'm not listening to your prayer. I'm not hearing a thing you got to say. Huh? In other words, you treat your wife right, or I'm not listening to a thing you got to say. That's what Papa says. That's what He said. Huh? Are you listening to me? I know Peter, I know they translated Peter a little bit more King's English, but this is a very good translation. It's not colloquial either. Men, treat your wives right, or God's not going to listen to a thing you got to say. Come on now. That should cause everybody to stand up, sit up, listen up. If you want Papa to hear you, why doesn't God hear me? Because you're a rascal. Because you need to straighten up, you're messing with his daughter. Huh? And any dad who has a daughter knows how fathers feel about their daughters. Don't you mess with the daughters. All power shall come to bear. Think about how the Lord looks at us and He says, I want these dispositions, these characters, these attributes, this nature to be manifested in your life so that your light may shine before men and they will behold the glory of your Father in your life. That by seeing these attributes, these dispositions, I'm strengthening you with all power so that by the glorious kratos, you might walk in this disposition of continual patience and continual endurance, and especially within the framework of relationships, because that's the most important place wherein patience and endurance or faithfulness and joyfulness needs to be expressed. Giving thanks always to God who has made you able to be a holy one in the light, a saint in the light. Come on, men. Think about this crown of life. Think about this diadem of divine grace. Come on. Let that be where the spotlight shines forevermore. These dispositions of the nature and the goodness of God. Knowing that God has done something so wonderful for us. He's translated us out of this darkness, out of this demon-ruled world with all its chaos and all of its fighting and fussing and lying and cheating and broken covenant relationships, and brought us into the kingdom of the dear Son. That's where you're at right now. Brought us in. Come on, look at it. Verse 13. Hallelujah. I'm in the kingdom now. Somebody said, how can you be in the kingdom now? Because I got the king in my life. I got the king with me. And wherever the king goes, his kingdom's with him. Everywhere he trots, it's his kingdom. All that he possesses is part of his realm. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to receive the life of Jesus. I command you to receive the life of God in such a way. I command you to drink of this relationship, of this fellowship, so that out of your belly will begin to rise up a response to the joyous call, the joyous privilege of relationship, an unlimited flow of His divine disposition and goodness. In Jesus' name, have a happy life from this day forward. Have a good life. For the fruits of the Spirit are in all righteousness and goodness and truth. And come on, and the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's righteousness and joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. I mean, come on, man. The fruits of the Holy Spirit are love and joy and peace and long-suffering and gentleness and goodness. My, and faith and meekness and temperance. He gives you great confidence and boldness that you can look eye to eye with the mightiest man upon the earth and have total authority to speak truth and not back down one iota from the realms of divine principle as the mouthpiece of God, as the witness of Father's will and purpose. Hallelujah. Nikesatoya Paya. I want to lay hands on every one of you right now. Sikana Masatayana. Just receive. Just receive that free gift. That unlimited free gift. Just receive right now. That unlimited free gift. Just receive right now. Into your mind, into your spirit, into your body, into your being. So you think different. You think in a God kind of a way, in a Jesus kind of a love, in a Jesus kind of a faith. And you become the person that's in charge. God's made you the boss. First of your own life, and then of everything around you. They would try to oppose the will of the Father. You're the enforcers. Hallelujah. Begin to enforce His will upon your own life. Hallelujah. He's given you kratos, glorious kratos, power to control, power to rule. In Jesus' name, no longer shall Satan be able to overshadow you. No longer shall he be able to influence your mind and thinking, but rather be overshadowed by the glory of the living God, ruled and kept by the Word of God. If you find yourself in a wilderness place or a desolate place or a challenging place, just know that the Lord has led you there that you might learn to live by the Word of God, by the Word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, not by just bread, not just by material and earthly means, for there's another realm in which you should live. And Father has chosen to teach us there in a place of total reliance upon Him when it looks like everything's working against us and nothing's working out and there's no inheritance and there's no provision, as it were. He's there teaching us to trust Him. Only trust Him. Only trust Him now. He will save you. He will save you. He will heal you. I pray that your voice will begin to lift up, be lifted up by the Holy Spirit towards heaven, and you'll be able to cry out with me for the mighty army of God to rise on the earth, for the high praises of God to be upon our lips, a sharp two-edged sword in our hand. I pray in Jesus' name. I pray that you'll cry out to God with the same desperation for Pentecost as there's been over the centuries when revival shook the earth. Oh, God would shake the earth again through you should you just abandon yourself to heaven and leave this world behind. He's calling you. He's calling you to have a new set of values, a new set of principles, a new set, a new way of thinking. Here, I promise you today, I promise you, you will live in divine health. You will live in divine blessing. You will live in divine provision. You will live in divine perfection. Just do these things. Just do these things. Give all attendance to making your calling and election sure. Recognize that you are his witnesses. You're the witnesses of his very love and grace and mercy to a lost and dying world. And this is where that witness must shine, because there's been abuses in every area of life. It's time now for the character of Jesus Christ to be seen. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Everybody, would you just stand with me? Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon your people. Father, we thank you that you gave to us this divine power and ability. Hallelujah. All power. Hallelujah. Strengthened by all power. Samson was not strengthened with all power. He was not strengthened with all power. He just was strengthened with some power. Jesus, on the other hand, was strengthened with all power. Hallelujah. Who tasted death for every one of us, that through his death we might live out his life. That we might be raised up together with him and seated together with him in a heavenly realm. Come on, church. Come on, God's people. Start thinking different about yourself. Don't be conformed to this world, but rather start thinking different about yourself. Don't be conformed to this world, but rather be transfigured by thinking different about yourself. Don't think according to the former things, but now be renewed, or think different about yourself by the Spirit of the living God, and take unto yourself this wonderful new man, new creation, new nature. Hallelujah. This oneness with God. Get out of the value system of this world, and this world will never be able to steal your affections from heaven anymore. Get out of the value system of the money and all of the other stuff. Get over into the riches of heaven. Hallelujah. You'll begin to shine. Oh, your only interest will be his presence and the glory of his presence. The measure and the value of your life will be his manifest glory in your life. The sense that he's here. He's here. Did you know he's here? Let me say this. Father, bless me with an ability to interact with him, to know him, as he has all men. I've taken him up on it, and by his grace, he's allowed me to have some things that are so wonderful. But there is an event that takes place in the midst of his house. I always find him. Listen, I have a time where I go to prayer, and Papa's always waiting for me. That's what happens. One day I was really busy with a bunch of things going on, and I said, no, it's prayer time. I'm going to prayer. And I heard the Spirit of the Lord speak to me, Father, saying, thank you for meeting me here. He knows how busy we are. He's mindful of all the things that we've got to get done, that we think we need to get done, and how we promote him to our number one interest. He's there waiting, and then I didn't show up. Oh, what a tragedy. And then when Father and I go there, and Father always speaks to me, he's always there waiting as I walk with him in the beauty of his paradise. But when I come to church, Father's waiting in a unique way. I want every one of God's people to be able to experience what I'm talking about right now, where you literally feel the overwhelming fire of his presence. When I come to church, I feel the overwhelming fire of his presence. I feel the glory of the Son. I feel and sense and are moved by the high praises of the Spirit of the living God. Father wants this to be a reality. This is a grace. It's given to every man. Now all of a sudden, everything changes about the dynamics of your interaction. But I'm going to tell you this. What will steal that from you is because your heart and your affections are things of this world. It'll steal this from you. If you didn't be risen with Christ, set your affections on things above. Not on things of this world. Set your affections in the realms of heaven, the realms of the Spirit, the realms of the Father's will. You begin to see. You begin to see. You begin to see. You begin to see. Hallelujah. Sakaradaha. Malasatoya. I want everybody to just join hands with one another across this place. Just join hands with one another. Because I want the flow of the anointing come touch you right now. I want you to feel at this very moment the strengthening power of the Holy Ghost. Samson says, oh Lord, strengthen me yet one more time. Strengthen me yet just once more. I command you to be strengthened right now by the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. Nambarata, with all power. With all power, with all kratos, with all power according to his glorious kratos. Now in Jesus' name, that you walk around in patience and endurance and joyfulness, giving thanks always to God the Father, who's made you able candidates, who made you able living expressions of his own person. Saints in light, strengthen now. Hallelujah. Strengthen now to praise him, to know him, to walk with him, to worship him, to serve him, to be used by him, to stand in his stead, to represent him to all humanity. Oh, to shine with his goodness, to shine with his joy, to shine with the brightness of his goodness in his life. Now in Jesus' name, I break off the pains of death. And now in Jesus' name, I break off the pains of death. I break off the shame of sin. I break off the power of doubt and unbelief. Be strengthened now. Be healed in your body. Be healed in your mind. Be healed now in your emotions. Be healed right now and your passions be made whole. Hallelujah. Let the water courses of his love, let the water courses of his joy, let the water courses of his peace, let the water courses of his endurance, of his gentleness, of his goodness, of his faith, of his meekness, of his temperance, course through your being now. Let his lowliness and meekness, let his goodness and righteousness fill you and overwhelm your heart. Hallelujah. 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 Father, we ask you right now to give us, Lord, the lost for our inheritance. Give us the uttermost parts of the earth for our possession. May we enjoin ourselves this day to that inheritance that you gave to Christ Jesus, who went to only one nation upon the earth during his sojourn in this life. And that was the nation of Israel, to raise us up then out of that realm to now go to the uttermost parts of the earth. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that every soul in this place from this day forward will be dedicated to the revelation of that which belongs to you, O God, in every disposition, in every attitude, in every display of your power. Father, I pray as those who leave this place, oh God, they walk out of here, if they go to eat in a public place or whatever it is, wherever they go, that they'll be shining as lights. There will be that glad disposition, that countenance that has been touched with the presence of the Lord. You decide today. God's word has come to you, and God's word has given you the power and the ability to live the kind of life that I just described. The power of the Holy Ghost is here hovering over God's word and God's creation of your life, ready to infuse you, ready to embolden you, ready to give to you this ability, this divine disposition. But you decide. You have to decide today. Some people, baseball, basketball, their job, their entertainment is more important to them. They're more excited about it than they are about the things of the Lord. And yet they attend church every day. You need to change that. You need to be willing to change that. Their titles among men, you need to be willing to change that. Your interest in earthly things, you need to be willing to change that right now. If you will, you'll discover all these good things. You discover that Father has the ability to take care of his people without them going to a job. Yeah. I'm looking forward to the great movings of God that produces such a harvest and such a revival that we need all people, all hands on deck, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, because there's so many souls to process, so many people to help. Come on, man. That's all I'm living for. I'm living for the harvest. That's all I'm living for. I'm living for the great outpourings and display of God's divine glory. Listen, we're getting ready to host a meeting here. Of course, Brother Ewan is going to be here the first of the month, but on the 17th, 18th, and 19th, Patrick Schatzlein is going to be here along with some other ministers, and it's going to be a three-night meeting. And it's really all about holiness, a return to holiness, a return to the secret place with God. And it's under the banner of I Am Remnant. Those are the people of God. God's always got a remnant. A remnant primarily being defined as the piece of cloth that wasn't suitable for the garment that men designed. That's me. I pray that's you. That you have no kinsmanship with this world, but your kinsmanship is everything in heaven with Christ Jesus. And I want you to listen, I want you to shout it out. I want you to go, if you've got influences with other churches, other youth groups, see Ruth Anna and Daniel, but they're basically leading the way on this. I want you to go get the word out. And it's not for us, it's not about seeing people come unto us. We are wanting to see people come unto Christ Jesus, come unto cooperation, participation with the things of the kingdom of God. This is absolutely with no self-interest. I want you to lift up your voice and shout it out. I want you to get the word out. Get as many people here from youth groups as possible. I want you, every one of you guys in this place, to recognize you can't get assimilated and neutralized by the world. You need to get a hid away in the glory. You need to wrap the anointing and mantle of God around your head and stop participating with all the stuff that everybody else is excited about, because if you're excited about what everybody else is excited about, you're no different from the world. You're not a light. A light is that which stands completely opposed and opposite of everything that is in this darkness of this world. Everything opposite of the world. I just pray that you'll fast and pray with me for the impact and the effectiveness of this upcoming meeting. I know that Patrick's fasting and praying for this meeting. He believes there's something very significant that's going down. I said, Patrick, we've had so much trouble, man. We're just going to have you out in the parking lot. He said, I so believe in what God wants to do and what he's purposed to do in San Diego. I'm happy to be in the parking lot. So we're getting ready. We need people to help us, and we're going to design a platform. We're going to build a platform. There's got to be a platform team to build the platform. I want a group of people to design a lighting system, basically a string of lights, of floodlights that can be run all the way around the perimeter. We've got some other ideas, but if you have any skill set in electricity, you know, doing that kind of thing, or know where to get those kinds of lights that already exist, let us know, because we need a lot of help. We've got to basically, you know, a little over 4 weeks to get ready. We want to put up a banner right over here on the side of the building that says, I am Remnant. October 17th through 19th. We want to have another larger banner up here stretched across the trees that the people could see on the highway. Once again, I am Remnant. And it doesn't need any more explanation than that. Just let the curiosity be stirred and then pray over it. The people's curiosity be stirred. I want to see the youth called to a holiness. I want to see the youth in this church, in every church, value and esteem the beauty of hanging out with the Holy Ghost more than hanging out with whatever it is that's going on in the interest of this world. Because I see too many people in and out. Watch out, folks. And you know, we're talking about this. I see too many of the youth in and out. One, you know, a couple of weeks they're shining with the glory, and then a couple of weeks they're shrouded with the world. Stop that back and forth stuff. Why don't you pray with us? Why don't you cry out to God that His glory and His presence would become a living reality to you, because you'll never go back when it does. Listen to me. I so want the people in the churches here in San Diego. And I don't care who the Lord uses. If there is another church that becomes more submitted and yielded to the Holy Spirit, Father, use them. And I'll go join them. We'll just go league up with them, you know. I'm just looking for people become so passionate about the things of God that Father's able to do what He wants to do. It's not, Father's not limiting us. He's waiting on us to cooperate. And so wherever the heart is stirred to say, I'm going all the way with God. Imagine a company of people saying, I'm going all the way with God. And you know, the Lord, I know that the Lord has given us a glorious opportunity to be first in this thing. I know He has. But it doesn't mean He hasn't left anyone else out. I believe everybody's got first opportunity. Well, who's going to step up? Because I'm going to tell you right now, if I watched another ministry in this city begin to move in the display of God's holiness and power, all I could do would be drop my head in shame and say, Father, I'm sorry for failing You. Sorry that I wasn't willing to go all the way. And then I go join them and get into it. Amen. So you decide, what are you going to do? Are you going to be a leader in the things of the Spirit? Are you going to put God first before anyone else puts Him first, or along with everybody else putting Him first? Or are you going to be the person who comes late? Says, wow, that's really working over there. However you get in, get in. Whether you're first or last, get in. Get in. But why don't you just go ahead and let God live His life through you and understand the greatness of what it means to participate with the moving of heaven in the earth today, with the revelation of Jesus, where there's been so much revelation of Satan. Holiness. Many people have misunderstood it. You know what holiness is? It's the overwhelming encounter with the presence in the person of the living God. That's what holiness is. It touches you and marks you so much that you live your whole life captivated by that realm. And as Joshua, you don't depart. You're just there. You're just there. Just wanting to see more. Experience more of His presence and of His goodness. Because His life is so good. His life is so glorious and wonderful, isn't it? Isn't God's life so wonderful and beautiful? You can all get happy about that. You can all be responsive to that, because it's an act of thanksgiving. Let me just try that one more time. And isn't His life just so wonderful and beautiful? Yeah, and let me adjust that a little bit for you. Let me adjust that a little bit for you. When you respond to that, respond directly to Him, not to me. When you let this take another level of maturity in your life, and if you're willing,
all power is given to you. If you're willing, all power is given to you to do it. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, bless the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. Just acknowledge Him by your giving. And watch what He does with you. Be a good steward. Live to give. And watch what Father will do. He'll provide more for you to be able to give. Make it sacred. Let your seed be sacred. Let it be something that is very, very valuable to you, important to you, meaningful to you. And worship Him with it. And watch what God will do. He'll multiply it. So just come worship the Lord with your giving. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. If anybody wants prayer for anything, come. I'll be happy to pray with you and for you. And I know that the Lord Jesus will touch you. If you need prayer for anything, come. If you have sickness in your body, hurt in your soul, if you're plagued with torment and harassment, just come. The Lord will touch you. He'll heal you. Whatever your need may be, just present it to the Lord. He's here to meet your need. He's an amazing provider and giver of life. Thank you, Jesus. Malasta peredeo. Malasta peredeo resia tutani. I want to pray for those of you who are not passionate about the things of God. I want to pray for you that just don't even see how to make a connection with the things that I described by the Holy Ghost here today. I want to pray for you. You're going to have to make the things of heaven meaningful to you and valuable to you. Otherwise, they'll never exist in your life. Jesus and the things that He talks about and the realms that He's made available is going to have to become a treasure to you. It's going to have to become a pearl of great price for which you're willing to sell everything for is so meaningful to you. And if that's not a reality in your life, if these things are not meaningful to you, if they haven't stirred you to change, then let me pray for you, because otherwise another day delayed will ultimately secure you
in a realm of darkness that will forever keep you from walking with the Lord. If you're not passionate about these things, why don't you come? Why don't you come? Let me pray for you. If your heart is cold and indifferent, you're lukewarm, and the Lord's not going to have fellowship with you, and you're going to, then what's going to happen is what we're talking about and what we're doing is going to be meaningless, and you're going to go look for fulfillment and other stuff out there. You're going to be snared by everything that Satan can stuff inside you. You're going to wake up one day and your life is going to be destroyed. And all the good opportunities that you had were missed. Don't run the risk of not having fellowship. Don't run the risk of being lukewarm or indifferent. I just know that the Lord is not done, and so many people have already run out of the building to go do what it is that they're going to do. And the Lord wants to bring a great change in your life for the better. Let him. I'm going to come by and I'm going to lay hands on you. My wife and I are going to lay hands on you. And when we do, we want you to be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. If you need physical healing, then be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. Be healed. If you need encouragement, then be strengthened by the Lord and be filled. Whatever it is that you have need of. If you're cold and indifferent towards these things in God, if they're meaningless to you, if they don't really have any value or any purpose for you, let the Lord touch you, strengthen you. So that which is in his heart will also be in your heart.